Hey everyone, Davey here, and in the past 12 months, my Shopify stores have done over $150 million. Today we're here with influencer queen Greta Van Riel, and we're going to talk to you about how to start with influencers.
I think that I stumbled almost across influencers by accident. So when I first started my first startup, Skinny Me Tea, it was back in 2012, and an influencer actually, this influencer from Tasmania, who I still know, Brooke, she actually bought our tea and posted on it, and she had about 1,000 followers at the time. And we had our best day of sales ever. And I was like, what is this? Okay, so every time I see a girl of that sort of demographic, like of our target audience on Instagram, and she has over 1,000 followers, I'm gonna just message her and send her our tea. Now, for my brands alone, we've probably worked with close to 10,000 influencers and probably close to another 10,000 on behalf of our clients at Hey Influencers. It's become, I guess, a little bit more of an art. I wouldn't necessarily say, okay, any girl with 1,000 followers or any girl with, I know Triangle's strategy was always any girl with over 5,000 followers they were happy to send a bikini out to. When Instagram took away the chronological newsfeed, definitely impacted a lot of reach and engagement for influencers, because now obviously there's the Instagram algorithm, which is, you know, affected by a huge number of different factors as opposed to just timeliness, which is actually probably maybe like, I would say like the fifth down in terms of factors. I'd say like engagement and how quickly a post does get engagement definitely determines the reach of the post the most these days on Instagram. I think that influencers are just very much, they're more commercially aware these days, and they understand what their impact is as well. A lot of, you know, brands do share their influencer results with the influencer that they worked with, or even sometimes on an affiliate structure, and the influencer can see their directly attributed sales in that way. So it's quite like broadly understood. I always talk about the three R's when it comes to selecting the right influencer to work with. So there's reach, and then there's relevance, and then there's relationship. And I would put the most emphasis on relationship. They're definitely more suitable almost for a startup than an established business. I think a lot of influencers, a lot of my girlfriends or guy friends that are influencers themselves, are much more inclined to work with a startup than a big corporate, and especially on a lower budget or even in a gifted capacity. So I think that startups are really able to take advantage of that sort of perception of them as a smaller company, someone growing, somebody, you know, Australian founded or female founded, or, you know, from some sort of diverse background. Like a lot of the time, those things are really, really well received by influencers, and a founder story is a really, really important part to play as well. What you need to remember first is that if you want to be running a gifting campaign, that it's a numbers game. If you want to be running a paid budget campaign, it's a relationship game. So to begin with, from a numbers perspective, you can't get too offended if you reach out to 100 influencers and you get 10 responses. I know for very established clients of ours, we might reach out to 100 influencers and we might get 30 to 40 responses. That would be sort of the average. But for a brand new company, fresh out the gates, depending also on their sort of like feed aesthetic, I think like that is a foundational step as well with influencers. If you don't have a beautifully curated Instagram feed, even first initial nine tiles, it doesn't have to be anything crazy. But if you haven't put a little bit of effort and work into that, then influencers will be much less inclined to work with you, and especially in a gifted capacity, because also they want to stay on the platform. If you reach out to them via direct message and they jump across to your Instagram account, there's nothing there, or your product doesn't feature, or it doesn't sound interesting or exciting to them, or something that they might not want to kind of align themselves with aesthetically and, you know, in terms of brand values, then they'll just keep going. So that would be one of the number one steps. Get your Instagram account into a good place, because that's like your foundation. Then I guess the next thing would be, when you're reaching out, say you've made a list of 100 influencers to reach out to, you would want to, what we do for 100 influencers, for 1,000 influencers, whatever, is what we do is we create a blank Instagram account. and we won't call it anything to do with the brand name or anything because it's just too searchable. Let's say it's for the hoodie. Mm-hmm. We'd say like Comfort Wear 12345, and it absolutely does not matter what that account's called. It will never be publicly facing. It's just a list building account. It's so that we don't have to constantly spreadsheet and then check the spreadsheet if it's got like 2,000 influencers. Mm-hmm. If you're already following them, clearly you've already reached out to them. So it's a process like that. So you might follow 100 people and then you start to work through the reach outs to those 100 people from that account. Mm-hmm. And you can search on Instagram, both on the web app and the mobile app, by date followed recently, and just make sure that you're always remembering where you got up to in that list as well. Then the next sort of step is obviously once you've built your list and once you've, you know, got your Instagram, that foundational step into place, once you've built that list, you basically are moving on to the outreach stage. And I cannot stress this enough, brevity is king in outreach. And then what I mean by that is like simplicity is always going to win. We have tested so many different outreach messages, but like what is always going to work the best if you're doing a gifting campaign, for example, is, hey, we'd love to send you an hoodie. Let us know if you're interested. Literally like a sentence, maybe like, let us know if you're interested at the end, or literally just like, hey, we'd love to send you a calming blanket, and then just like a cute little sparkle emoji or something. If we're working with the hoodie, for example, you know, what we generally ask for would be a post and a feed post and two Instagram stories. And we make sure that the influencer's also aware and it, you know, agrees to the fact that they'll post within 2 weeks of receiving the product. Mm-hmm. So that's a really important step too, setting a sort of timeline around that. Follow-ups are very, very critical. And the timeliness of your follow-ups. But that's why having that 2 week buffer is really great too, because then you can start to send, you know, messages when it gets a little closer to that, being like, okay, so, you know, like obviously aware of your time, you know, you're very, very busy, but yeah, it's coming to the end of the campaign period and we're just trying to wrap up results and everything. So if you could just let us know, or we say that we use gifting campaigns as a testing ground almost for our paid collaborations. So, you know, if you don't post, we're just not really going to know how it went and we can't, you know, offer like a higher budget campaign next time.
I think one thing your agency does so well is like after we prove that there's a successful kind of relationship there and everyone can profit from it, including the influencer, you know, you do build that relationship. That relationship goes both ways, not only with their followers, but also with our product and our business. So then you keep, you know, working that, yeah, generally has a lot more upside in the long term.
So what we do is, say we're doing 100 Instagram send outs in Australia. Out of those 100, if we find 20 to 30 people that convert well on behalf of the hoodie, we will re-collaborate with them in a paid capacity. So those 20 to 30 people, the compounding sort of results of them being able to collaborate with them for like 2 to 3 months after that campaign will put them on a 2 to 3 month package, which then means obviously, you know, it's like it's better because we've got that, you know, locked in sort of relationship, locked in rate as well.
Easier to work, less friction.
Exactly. Now we use a lot of Google Forms for our collaborations. So once they say, for example, yes, I'm interested in working with the hoodie, we're like, great, just fill this little form out with your, you know, hoodie of choice and a few other details. And when they tick that box at the bottom, they're agreeing to the terms of the campaign. And we have the terms quite clearly displayed, like the posting within 2 weeks. For example, not working with any competing brands for 2 months is another great one. Mm-hmm. Ad consent. Mm-hmm. So for the content side. So like there's four main things that you kind of want to get out of an influencer relationship. And content is always going to be the first thing. I'm not saying that it's the most important. Obviously, conversions are. Mm-hmm. But content is always going to be the first step. And no matter how that content converts on social, the good side is if you've got their consent for that content to be used in your advertising now, you might come across a winner there too. You've got to start with, I think, at least 30 collaborations, depending on the price point of your product. If you're quite high price point, I'd say 30. I would love to say 50 to 100 for a lower price point or like CPG style brand. Of course, there's like false engagement metrics. That's a really key one. A lot of micro influencers are in pods, so like engagement pods. So they might be in like a group chat on like Instagram or on even like Telegram. They will post saying into the group, saying they've just posted, and then everyone will go and engage from the group. A good way to be able to see whether someone's in a pod or not is just discrepancy in the number of comments that they get. So say they usually get like exactly almost like 100 comments every time, you're like, debatable. Sometimes they get 40, sometimes they get 120, sometimes they get 180, sometimes they get 10. That discrepancy in the commenting is actually like a really positive sign, because it shows, I mean, even if they are in a pod, who cares? Like, if, you know, it might help boost the post slightly within the algorithm anyway. And a lot of the time, a lot of the other influencers in their pod might want to collaborate with your brand once they've seen that influencer do it too. So there can be, you know, positives and negatives. Say we did 30 send outs, and out of those 30 send outs, we found 5 people that converted really well. Then it's looking into the reasons why they converted well. Was it, you know, that their audience was really, really well aligned with the brand? Was it that they're in a particular niche, like for calming blankets, mums convert very well? You know, was, you know, 4 out of 5 might have been mums, for example. And then we're like, okay, let's lean further into the mum market or niche. When we're building that initial list, we'll find one influencer to work off to begin with, or like one in each niche. We might find one TikTok boy, one mum, and one gamer that all perfectly fit into, you know, our requirements, that reach, relevance, which is more niche, and relationship. And relationship is often demonstrated by their engagement rate. Sure. So if we find like super highly engaged people, and then we're able to work, you know, off the back of those, then we just use the similar 2 little drop down. So when you follow them, Instagram suggests more accounts. And Instagram's always going to have the best data of any of us. Facebook, Instagram have the best data on their accounts. Like, we could not search for days and find a more similar account than what Instagram's going to suggest there as well, because it does things like follower overlap is a really big one as well. And it's a really important thing within campaigns too. Like, if you're only going to send out to 10 people, you want those 10 people to have as much of a follower overlap as possible. Like, a lot of brands say, oh, but we'll just be reaching the same person. It's like, yeah, exactly. Like, suddenly those combined followers, say there's 20 and you've reached out to, say you've reached out to 10 and they've got 20,000 each, there's 200,000 people that have a strong like overlap in audience. So it's not actually 200,000, it could actually be like 40,000 people total, but they're much more likely to see your brand mentioned 2 or 3 times, and then they, you know, it starts to have those flow on effects. Like, I call it the everybody's doing it effect, whereby people are like, oh wow, you know, there's brands everywhere, I'm seeing them, like the Udi's ads, like who has not seen and then seen another Udi ad, another Udi ad, another Udi ad, and then you just start to be like, this brand is doing well. They're quite cool. Oh, hang on, I'm gonna tap through to their Insta. Oh wow, that girl that I follow was wearing one. I'm gonna tap through to their website. Oh, they've got a sale on, I'm gonna buy. So it often, of course, as we know, takes like a few touch points to be able to convert somebody through to being a customer. So it's a really strong thing when there's a lot of follower overlap as well. As we know, influencer marketing is inherently difficult to track or attribute results, but you know, there are a few things that are a lot better to have in place before you even get a campaign started. So first up, there's tracking through your spreadsheeting. So that's just from the campaign administration sort of side, like, has the influencer, you know, received their product? Have they, you know, have you done a follow-up? The next thing that you want to do is to be able to track whether the influencer has posted or not. If you're only sending out to like 10 influencers, for example, that's pretty simple. You just, you know, keep an eye on their socials. You might turn on post notifications. And of course, you ask the influencer to tag your brand when they post as well. So you can probably keep an eye on it in that way. With the Udi, where we do 550 send outs in a month, it gets a little more complicated. So for platforms like Instagram, we use a tool called Mighty Scout that can basically track, you know, whether the influencer has posted or not, and to some end also their discount code use. So that's another thing within the campaign. For every influencer, micro, macro, mid-tier, everything in between, we always give them a discount code. Another one that we're starting to implement more so across the board is UTM trackable links, because then obviously you can retarget that audience as well. One of our top converting macro influencers for the UDI is Mitch Orville and also his partner Chloe Zepp. We work super closely with Mitch and Chloe. Love you guys.
Absolute legends.
Salt of the earth. Incredible. I think what Mitch and Chloe do that's so different is they're so interactive with their audience. Mm-hmm. They're so responsive. They build such a strong relationship. Like, I know Mitch spends like 2 to 4 hours a day replying to all his Instagram DMs.
Wow.
Like, he will personally reply to most people that reach out to him. Instagram, of course, like Facebook and like Facebook ads, is rewarding brands being responsive with their audience or influencers being responsive with their audience. So that's a huge tip.
So the UDI's done over 7 figures in influencers alone in the past 12 months under your management. But I think one thing that we're both extremely bullish on and how to really grow that is whitelisting, which is kind of not really mainstream at the moment. I know some bigger brands are jumping onto it, but you know, a lot of the new e-commerce people might not be, you know, really familiar with it. Can you explain what that is and how to go about it?
It's called a few different things. It might sometimes be called whitelisting. It can also be called just a Facebook ad takeover. So basically, it's when a brand is given advertiser access to an Instagram's Facebook page or Instagram account. Often those are linked as well, or if they're not, they need to be before we can whitelist. And then a brand is able to basically run ads through that influencer's handle. And so the good part for influencers and what they love is that they don't have to be posting to their following to be monetizing their audience at that point either. So brands will often pay influencers either like an access fee to that account or a content fee. So they might so they might be paying, you know, say like $300 per video ad, and then the influencer will basically create a video ad that will then, you know, demonstrate the brand, the product, them using it, speaking about it. You know, it might be a review, it might be, you know, an unboxing, it might be, you know, how to use the product, it might, you know, like a recipe or, you know, how to style something in a particular way. So that sort of like content layer is really important too, of course, in getting whitelisting to convert. So that's, I guess, like the foundational step is creating like that great high converting content with the influencers on that, in that regard. Then the next step is obviously connecting the accounts. So getting the influencer to add the brand as a advertiser to their Facebook ads manager. And from that point onwards, obviously, it's structuring and running the ads. From a brand's perspective, what's really cool is, say you're doing this with a big macro influencers account, say they've got like my, yeah, like the influencer in Sydney I was talking about earlier, say they've got 500,000 followers on social media, you can target your ads directly to their following. You can target them to cold audiences, or you can even layer or create lookalikes out of like a compilation of both. So it's kind of like a best of both worlds sort of situation. And it works very, very effectively, both from a brand and an influencer perspective. So one, for an influencer, it's a great way to monetize your following without being, you know, constantly posting sponsored or paid ads all the time. And two, for an influencer, it will explode your social following. I mean, you've got to have the whole funnel in place. You need to be creating like high value, high converting content as well that connects with your audience, of course, as a base level. But when you do have that, the advertising side can be like a pretty incredible upside to influencers.
I think we should do a full video on our whitelist flow, how we onboard people.
So true.
Compare the results.
Yeah.
And then show people, because it was actually, you know, it's not mainstream, so therefore there's a huge education process that you need to go through with the influencers, which we found challenging.
Yeah.
Just to finish off, what we'll do is we'll compare two platforms, because that's often a question we get. So, you know, maybe you can be Instagram and I'll be YouTube.
I would hope I would get to be Instagram.
And let's go through the positives and the negatives, and I'll prove why YouTube's better.
Let's start with the negatives because I want to end on the positive note, okay. Actually.
Let's go.
For Instagram, obviously, reach has been throttled a lot from that change from the chronological newsfeed to the algorithmic-based newsfeed. Mm-hmm. That's a pretty big negative. From Instagram's perspective, it's also, I guess, like a very aesthetic, sort of curated platform. And from that relationship perspective, like we were talking about earlier, and I think you're gonna try to owe me with this point, a lot of the time, YouTubers are able to build a great relationship with their audience and influencers on Instagram. You know, there's still some great tools there, like going live, obviously, like Mitch and Chloe replying to a lot of their DMs and that sort of side as well. So they're two of the sort of like downsides of Instagram. I guess like obviously from an upside perspective, one of the huge things is the ease of collaboration on Instagram as well. If you want to do 100 collaborations on YouTube, that'd be honestly like a full-time staff member's day-to-day, all day, every day. If you want to be doing that on Instagram, it's a lot easier of a process. YouTube's a lot harder to, you know, there's no messaging function on YouTube. It's quite hard to reach out. YouTubers get like hundreds of emails, and if they have management, then it's even more difficult. And if they have management, they're not going to do a gifting campaign with you, for example. So the ease of collaboration is really, really great on Instagram. From a results perspective, we've had obviously incredible results for years off the back of Instagrammers. And I think that something that you can also do is like Instagram influencers that also have a YouTube, or Instagram influencers that also have a TikTok, finding those and collaborating with those, because a lot of the time, if their YouTube is larger than their Instagram followers will be like their absolute super fan communities. So you're going to be able to access that like super fan base that have come across, followed them all the way from YouTube across to Instagram as well. They might have 500K on YouTube and like 50K on Instagram, or they might have like a million followers on TikTok, which happens actually quite frequently, and then like 20K on Instagram. And the good part is, obviously, one, they're going to charge a lot more for that collaboration on YouTube, or a lot more. So again, price side.
Definitely.
Yeah. Good luck trying to find YouTubers that like are not literally just like an everyday human being with like 100 subscribers that will accept a gifting campaign. So budget wise, Instagram kind of will win out.
So I think one benefit with YouTube that is often overlooked is the SEO component, and the fact that, you know, or YouTube is as a search engine as a whole. So you can rank for certain keywords. Let's say you've got a fitness app and you want to do a proper, you know, what is the best fitness app and why with your influencers. You can then rank for that, which provides like a long lasting bit of traffic. I know that some of our discount codes that are ranking higher for SEO still provide conversions even after 12 months after you set them up.
So. Yeah, I don't want to really drive this point home for you on your behalf within the debate, but I can't not say it in the industry. But obviously Instagram, we call it like a half-life. It has a much shorter half-life than YouTube. So Instagram, you know, while you might get incredible results and like quite intense fast-acting results, like a huge spike in traffic or sales from, you know, in the first like 48 hours of your post, after 72, there isn't going to be too much more. There are, of course, ways to help mitigate that. Influencers adding, you know, the discount code and the link into their link tree or into their bio, for example, and like following it up with more stories and obviously then posting again. But like, yeah, from that end, like YouTube does really have those like longer lasting results a lot of the time as well.
For sure. And I think to your point where just the style of content. Obviously, Instagram is predominantly photos or short form video. It's also not educational as, you know, a search engine. So therefore, the YouTube content is, you know, people are much more susceptible to buy, and you can educate them through a long form video content.
Yeah, a lot of the time, I mean, people go onto YouTube, if they're watching a video that has the word review in it, they're doing that because they're already an interested buyer. as well. Like they're in that sort of like consideration stage of the funnel, as opposed to being an entirely cold audience that on Instagram that just, you know, that ad or content is just thrust in their face as well a lot of the time when it comes to the search side.
I think when selecting YouTube influencers, it's really important to also look at like kind of their momentum and their growth. What are some other kind of key things, or can you elaborate on, you know, how to actually select YouTube influencers?
Yeah. So there's a great platform for YouTube. It also exists for Instagram. It's a little bit less effective on Instagram, but it's a free platform called Social Blade. So you can basically see whether that influencer is on an upward or downward growth trajectory. So basically, if the influencer is growing month on month at like 1,000 to 2,000 followers, or you know, 5,000 to 10,000 followers, or if they're losing 1,000 to 2,000 or 5,000 to 10,000 a month, it is a really strong indication of how much obviously stickiness that content has with their audience, but also the relationship that they've got to. I think if they're losing, you know, followers quite consistently, they don't necessarily have as great a relationship with their audience, or they're not necessarily posting the types of content that their audience want to see and engage with. Their content style might have changed. So many influencers that I speak to don't understand why they might be losing followers. And my number one tip is always to look back at their content. And this is the same with brands. Go through your Instagram or YouTube or platform insights and see what your top performing form of content is and create more like that. Is the easiest, simplest step. Yeah.
Look, so it's getting pretty dark outside, as you can probably see, and we've actually got a dinner to go to. So I hope you enjoyed having Greta on today. So just make sure everything's trackable, make sure the influencers are relevant, keep the process simple, and just enjoy the process. Make sure you subscribe, and we'll see you next week. Happy with that?
Okay, great.